Good morning, congregation, and a special welcome to visitors as well on this lovely cooler day. Just to help us to prepare to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, let us sing 359, Worship the Lord in the Beauty of Holiness. So I'll just read the first verse. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Bow down before him, his glory proclaim. Gold of obedience and incense of lowliness bring, and adore him. The Lord is his name. So all five verses of 359.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. On behalf of the session, I warmly welcome you to this worship service, especially to our visitors this morning, that we may have a blessed time as we sing our praises and worship our Heavenly Father in spirit and in truth. The call to worship comes from Psalm 105, verses 1 to 4. Give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Brothers and sisters, let us seek the Lord in silent prayer and ask for his blessing on us this morning. Father, hear our prayers. Rest your Holy Spirit on us as we worship you and are under the preaching of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Congregation, please rise to receive the greeting of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, where does our help come from? Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. In the name of the Father, and Son of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the Lord welcomes us, grace unto us and peace, from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now worship the Lord with singing hymn 148, all verses, Hallelujah, Praise Jehovah. Brothers and sisters, God gave us his law not to save us from our sins, but to make us aware of our sins. It is like a mirror to show us how ugly, how sinful we really are. Let us think back over the past week. Let us reflect on the way we have been in word, in thought, and in deed towards our Heavenly Father and towards our neighbor. Turn with me now to Exodus 20, verses 1 to 17 for God's commandments. Exodus 20. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animal, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Let us pray. O God, most merciful and gracious Father, we confess that we have sinned against you and have grieved the Holy Spirit and have sinned against each other. We have not fought the good fight. We allowed ourselves to be guided by our sinful natures, by the world leaving your way and ignoring your word. Lord, forgive us and please cleanse us from our sin. Give us a contrite heart and a humble spirit. Let your mercy and grace come upon us in great abundance, and so help us to see the newness of life in your Son, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we can be sure of the Lord's forgiveness as we read in Psalm 103, words that will encourage us in our relationship with Jesus. We read, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. these words should fill us, dear Christian, with gratitude and joy. And now let us express our thankfulness to Jesus, our Savior, with the words of hymn 103, standing as we sing, praise God, my soul, with all my heart, let me exalt his holy name. We now come to the scripture reading, and the readings are from 1 Peter 4, 12 to 19, and Matthew 5, verses 1 to 12, and our brother Peter Rose will do the scripture readings.
So you'll see in your Bibles that the Peter one is headed up, suffering for being a Christian, and then Matthew 5 is to do with the Beatitudes, and of course at the end of the Beatitudes it says, rejoice, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So it's about suffering, as Taylor's preaching on today. So starting with 1 Peter then, dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, But praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with the family of God. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. So let's now move to Matthew chapter 5, with the Beatitudes, which are probably well known to you all, where it says, "Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God, or heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.'" This is the word of God.
Brothers and sisters, let us now seek God's face as we pray for our church. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God Almighty, God Triune, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Creator of the universe and all that is in it, we are here this morning to worship you in spirit and truth. Father, we thank you that we are able to meet together this morning and bring our praises, thanks, and requests before you. Father, we pray for a steadfast mind as we trust in you, so we may be kept in perfect peace. O Lord, you are the rock eternal, that we may rest on you, knowing that you are in control, giving us peace. Father, we thank you that you level the path of the righteous in Christ and make the way smooth, that we may walk according to your law, and that your name and renown may be the desire of our hearts. Father, we thank you for what you have done for us with your plan of salvation, that you sent your Son to a world which wanted nothing to do with you. But you called us to repent of our sins and to put our faith in your Son in order that we would have eternal life. O God, what a wonderful Father you are. Lord, grant that we as your children, as brothers and sisters of Christ Jesus, may stand firm in this world, and we thank you that we belong to a different kingdom. But it does mean that we as a church should let our light shine and be a salt in this world. Father, help us to do that, and that we stand out as a loving, caring community in our daily lives. Father, we thank you that we are able to be under the preaching of your word Sunday by Sunday, and thank you for those who are willing to prepare themselves, sometimes with very little time for preparation. Lord, we pray for the elders and deacons and ask that you lead them as they fulfill their respective tasks. Lord, we pray for faithful men who are willing to answer the call to eldership. Father, we pray that we may find a minister of the word to lead this flock in Aberdeen. Lord, you know the men. Bring us in contact with him. Grant wisdom to the calling committee in their search for one who will lead this flock. Father, grant wisdom from your word as the session deals with issues related to our worship and membership, that they may have a good understanding of the scriptures, be good listeners and are good encouragers as they point members to Christ, that they may be vigilant in keeping watch over the flock, may have discernment and may be aware of worldly influences in the church. Lord, we thank you for all who have been involved in renovating our place of worship, that we may meet here for many years to come, to sing our praises and glorify your name and be under faithful preaching of your word. We pray for us as members to be filled with the Holy Spirit daily as we live for Jesus, that we may have discernment and are aware of what is going on around about us, that we may see the pull of the evil one and are prepared to resist him. And we pray that especially for our teenagers, young people, that they may be protected from all the things in the world that promise much, but in the end will bring no satisfaction, no peace. Father, grant wisdom to parents with young children at home, that they may instruct the little ones early in life regarding your plan of salvation, that they may learn early about the sacrifices Jesus made to save sinners. Father, many in the congregation are not well, several for years now, and we ask, Lord, to rest your blessing on them and grant them your peace and blessing as they often cannot worship with us. We thank you that often they express a strong trust in their Heavenly Father, that he is indeed their comfort and strength during the times of the sickness and discomfort. Father, we ask to comfort the lonely brothers and sisters who grieve for their loved ones, or the singles who never married and would have liked to. Lord, we cannot understand your ways with us, calling your young ones home and grant others a long life. Yet your plan for each one is perfect. Father, we pray for healing for Heather Campbell, and we thank you, Lord, that she was able to return home again. We remember those from among our midst who have gone overseas to serve our Lord and Savior. We think of Janice Reed, who will soon return to settle down in New Zealand, and grant that she may find suitable accommodation. And we remember Marlene van Tonden, Peter and Joanna, the Watsons family, the Vandenengels, and others, and we ask you to sustain these in their labors, and that many may come to know the Lord and Savior through their labors. Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters in countries like China, North Korea, Indonesia, Africa, the Middle East, and so on, who are persecuted because they confess your name and are living according to your statutes, showing love to one another and to the poor and disadvantaged and their enemies. Father, uphold them, that they may stand strong in the Lord. Father, we thank you that often we see a strong church where persecution is more severe. Lord, we pray for the world, a world which is in disarray, a world who has thrown God out altogether, thinking that they can create utopia. O Lord, let them realize that without godly guidance, there will never be peace. Father, we thank you that you are in control of this world and that you have already gained the victory over Satan and death. We thank you that we do not have to live in fear, no matter what happens. Oh, Father, let us keep our eyes on Jesus the rock and not on our circumstances, living in such a way that we are ready when he returns to take up his church into the new heavens and the new earth. So, Lord, encourage us with your word this morning as we are being challenged to live a godly life in a godless society. Lord, be present with us this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let us now worship our Heavenly Father with our tithes and offerings.
Shall we just say grace? Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning in worship, and we give thanks to you in the knowledge that you are our sovereign God who holds this world in your hands. And with this knowledge, we put our faith and trust in you. Give our leaders of the world extra wisdom at this time as they navigate the COVID pandemic. Lord, we pray that you will use this pandemic to pave the way for a spiritual renewal in the world today. May all things work so that your will be done and your glory, power and healing be on display for all to see. Lord, these offerings we bring today are to support the work of your church and to be a light for Christ. Help us also to do this in our daily lives. And we pray all these things through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us stand to sing hymn 473, the first three verses. 473, lead on, O King Eternal. Let us pray. Father, guide us as we open your word and we meditate on it. Open our hearts and minds to receive your word, to take it in, and to apply it in our daily life. In Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters, 2 weeks ago, on Sunday evening, Ellen and I listened to Ray Bennett. His title was Persecution. I thought, oh no, as the sermon I present to you is also on persecution. But Ray's sermon was by a different minister. I think the Lord wants us to hear about persecution, as we may well experience it in the days to come. I believe that the Holy Spirit is in control of everything, and he was in control of choosing this sermon. The sermon is by the Reverend A.J. Kwak of the Christian Reformed Church of Australia. The text is Matthew 5, 11 and 12. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The title of the sermon is The Price of the Persecuted. And we look at three questions. What persecution? Why must Christians be persecuted? And thirdly, what is the response of the Christian to persecution? Congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to begin by making an assumption. There would not be many, if any, people in our congregation who have been physically abused because they stood up for their faith. Is that a fair assumption, congregation? When we hear of the atrocious suffering and abuse that members of the early church had to endure, and when we hear of modern-day persecution in places like the Sudan, Indonesia, and China, etc., it is obvious that persecution is a relatively unknown phenomenon to us. How should we respond to such a situation? If we are serious in our attitude to the Word of God, I think we may have a reason to be a little worried. Peter says we should not be surprised at the painful trial we are suffering. But how often is the opposite true? Instead of being troubled about our lack of persecution, we seem to have a different tendency that says, thank you, Lord, that I am not in circumstances of persecution. I do not think I could endure so much without falling away. What a shame these sorts of thoughts enter our hearts. For does not the Lord say to us through Matthew 5, 10 to 12, that the persecuted are blessed? As we come to see the application of the HP attitude, let us allow ourselves to be challenged. Here is a text that directs our attention to the dangers of complacency about lack of persecution. Being persecuted, Christians, is a consistent portrayal of our walk before the Lord. Being persecuted, Christians, is a consistent portrayal of our walk before the Lord. Is it a portrayal of our life? Does our Christian lifestyle and witness warrant attracting persecution? In a nutshell, people of God, as we compare our lives to the demands of this attitude, are we as faithful in our Christianity as Jesus expects us to be? Or are there certain unfaithful aspects which need to be confessed and worked at? Let us prayerfully take this journey together. We begin by asking ourselves, what persecution? When we turn to the Word of God, there are some obvious examples. Many of the Old Testament prophets were persecuted for their faithfulness to God, often by their own people. The prophet Jeremiah is a prime example. Our Lord Jesus Christ suffered persecution from many fronts while he walked this earth. Acts 7 is the first record of a Christian martyr, the first of thousands who were put to death for their faith in Christ. The New Testament record speaks many times of apostles and church leaders who were flogged, jailed, and even put to death for the Lord. Church history speaks of times when Christians were crucified for their faith. Others were burned at the stake. Still others were beheaded. Even in our day, in countries like China, Sudan, Indonesia, etc., attest to the fact that physical persecution exists. If we limit our understanding of persecution to these examples, it would be very unlikely, at least in the present climate, that the government of New Zealand would tolerate this type of physical persecution. Does that mean we should not expect to be persecuted for the sake of Christ? No, not at all. In verse 11, Jesus mentions three types of persecution, which can be expected by the Christian: being insulted, being physically persecuted, and having people speaking falsely all types of evil against us. We may not be physically beaten up, but if we are faithful in our witness, insults and false accusations should be part of our experience. Insults are a deliberate misrepresentation of one's character, and it is no wonder that persecution takes this form. Faithful Christians stand on one side with our Christ-like character, a character spoken of in the Beatitudes. On the opposite side stands the world, with their devil-like character poised to attack. What charge can people of this world bring against those who have the foundation of Christ-like integrity? None. For when the light of Jesus within our hearts shines brightly, we stand as faithful representatives of Christ. Consistent Christian characters are despised by our world. So the world resorts to insults to make us look bad. Meekness is weakness. Mourners are crybabies. Peacemakers only want to meddle into the affairs of others. Christianity isn't crutch, etc. They take the truth, bend it a little, and throw it back in our faces. They misrepresent our character. Insults are a form of being persecuted for the sake of Christ. When people resort to persecuting us by saying all sorts of evil against us, we can know they are getting desperate. The truth of God's word lived out in our lives is a truth which cannot be faulted in any way. Our truth stands on the integrity of God. False accusations are the only weapons the world has to try and drag us down. You are wrong for being anti-abortion, for you are compromising the rights of the mothers. You are being cruel by condemning euthanasia. Let people die with dignity. Don't discipline your children. You are going to scar them for life. Isn't it arrogant to say that your Savior is the only Savior which can get people to heaven? What about other good religious people? Persecution through false accusations of evil come our way because our standard is so different. Physical beatings may not be the sort of persecution we have to face. But when it comes to being persecuted for the sake of Christ, we should at least expect insults and false accusations to come our way. Bring to mind all the events you went through last week. Are any of these types of persecution included in those events? Call to mind the number of times you have endured insults and false accusations. Have those times been many? Enough to use all the fingers on both of your hands? As you keep your answers to these questions in mind, let us now explore a second issue which comes out of these verses in Matthew. Why must Christians be persecuted? Whenever you read the Beatitudes, one principle of application should always be entrenched in your mind. The Beatitudes are attitudes of Christians. All who give their allegiance to Jesus Christ are people who should be poor in spirit, mourners, meek, hungering and thirsting for righteousness, merciful, pure in heart, peacemakers, and persecuted. The Beatitudes are certainties of the Christian life. They are not optional extras. That places us in a predicament, doesn't it? On the one hand, most of us have to admit that persecution has little or no impact on our lives. Yet, on the other hand, if we consider ourselves to be members of the kingdom of God, then the Lord makes it clear. Persecution is a certainty. Let's get more personal. If we are not experiencing persecution in our lives, could it be that there is something a little untrue about our Christianity? Now, I'm not saying that we are not Christians, for all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Therefore, I'm not questioning God's grace to us and his calling in our lives. Rather, it is our expression of gratitude which comes into the spotlight. Jesus calls blessed those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness. Are we persecuted? Are we one of those blessed? Is our daily Christian witness of such a caliber that it attracts the attention of a world that hates God and hates us as representatives of God? What a dilemma we are in when we remember the numerous biblical passages warning the Christian to expect persecution. Why this expectation? Why should we expect people to be offended by our Christian witness? because Christ's salvation in our lives is something we cannot keep silent about. As a Christian, do you need to fear death? Not at all. Through the resurrection, death has lost its fear. Now it merely signals the beginning of a new stage in our lives, a step into the presence of the Father. As an adopted child of God, do you need to fear that God will forget you, his chosen one? Of course not. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, has promised that no one will be able to snatch his sheep out of his hands. Our election is sure. As a servant of the Lord, do you need to fear being denied the promises of God, even when you bring shame to the name of the Lord? Of course you don't. We have a Savior who was tempted with the same temptations that we have gone through. There is one at the right hand of the Father who knows our every weakness. And while he is sad when we bring shame to him, he always comes to us and says, "My grace is sufficient for you. My mercy is continually shown to my children." Such hope, joy, peace, and trust is the essence of our faith. If we have been made to respond to the calling of a Savior, whose sole goal while on this earth was to bring us to heaven before the throne of God, how can we sit in complacent silence? Is it appropriate that we let secular humanism take over what lawfully belongs to God? Is it appropriate that we let secular humanism take over what lawfully belongs to God? Does a faithful Christian sit on his or her hands, complaining that the task is too big, when they have the power of Jesus Christ as their support? Is it right for us to lessen our Christian witness because we might offend someone else? No, no, no. For the sake of Christ, for the sake of righteousness, for the sake of the Lord who is our first love, we must stand up in this world and bring the truth. And standing for the truth of the gospel brings persecution. Our prophetic calling in this world, our calling to speak of the wonders of God and the works that he has done, continues to be expected. And as the prophets of the Old Testament can affirm, this work goes hand in glove with persecution. Those who are loved by Christ can expect to be persecuted as they stand up for the Savior and his will, a Savior that the world hates and rejects. But this is God's will, a will to which the Son was sent to give life. And God is counting on us to defend his territory from the advances of Satan. But we are so afraid, aren't we? We find it so hard to go out of our way for the Lord, to speak up for what we believe, to declare that our standard is the norm for this world. We find it so hard to break out of fear, to speak against the status quo. We find it hard to offend our peers, friends, and associates with the offense of the gospel, for we don't want them to speak badly of us. We don't like speaking up for the Lord, even though he is the author of our salvation, even though he has given us eternal life, even though he has given us the mandate to be salt and light. We would rather that people speak nicely to us. But what does Jesus say in Luke 6:26. Woe to you when people speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets. Congregation, there is something unnatural about a Christian who is not persecuted for the sake of Christ. Something false. Indeed, being false about whom we are, being Christ's ambassadors, is the essence of being unfaithful. I think, indeed, being false about whom we are, being Christ's ambassadors, is the essence of being unfaithful. Let's be blunt for a moment. If your Christianity is such that it conforms nicely to the standards of the world in which we live, you will not be persecuted in any way because your life follows accepted worldly standards. But as soon as your witness for the Lord conforms to the standards of Christian living, persecution does come your way because you are seeking to live in this world using unacceptable and godly standards. We are talking here about the huge difference between being faithful in all areas of our Christian walk, particularly those that bring us in conflict with the world. What sort of person are you? A person who is persecuted as a direct result of standing up for the name of Jesus Christ? A person who is insulted because you proclaim Jesus as the only true path? A person who sets the biblical standard by demanding that God's law take precedence? A person who is faithful in all areas of life, not just at those times when Christian friends are watching? A person who is consistently serving God the whole week, not just at worship and church meetings? If this is the sort of person you are, then you are blessed, for persecution is sure to come your way. But if you are not enduring persecution, could the real reason for that state of affairs be that your life is not totally lived for the sake of Christ? Here is a text which directs our attention to the dangers of complacency about lack of persecution. Being persecuted Christians is a consistent portrayal of our walk before the Lord. So the challenge is shouted to us through the pages of Scripture. Being persecuted for the sake of Christ is a must. It is not an optional extra. But not only does the Lord challenge us, he also equips us with a way to deal with persecution. Let us face one final point which flows out of this text as we consider. What is the response of the Christian to persecution? Jesus says in verse 12 of our text, "Rejoice and be glad." Peter calls for the same response in 1 Peter 4. "Do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, but rejoice. If you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name." This is perhaps the most ironic demand that the Lord places on us. Our Lord wants us to stand up for his name, to be beaten, insulted, and endure false accusations, so that we can be joyful in our Christian walk. How is it possible for such a situation to bring joy? Joy comes because the Christian who is persecuted has the assurance from the Lord that the Lord considers him faithful. I read it again. Joy comes because the Christian who is persecuted has the assurance from the Lord that the Lord considers him faithful. Joy comes because we know God is using us as a tool, as his tool. We don't endure persecution as a way to enter heaven, a way to make God show us favor. Rather, we rejoice and are glad because we know that when persecution comes our way, all we are doing is following in the footsteps of those who have been declared by the Lord himself to be righteous. Matthew 5:12 mentions the prophets as an example of those who are persecuted. In faith and obedience, the prophets of old proclaimed the world of old proclaimed to the world the will of the Lord. They were unpopular. They were rejected. Some were scorned. Some were beaten. Some had to sustain severe punishment. But all of them were declared righteous by the Lord. All were called to the task and all fulfilled his word. The reaction of the people to the work of the prophets was a confirmation of a God-given calling. They proclaimed the truth of God's word, and the word affected the hearts of the people. We, who are Christians today, merely follow in their footsteps. There is a real sense in which we still have a prophetic calling, a calling which will bring persecution, but which will also bring us much assurance about our place in God's plan. How can we have assurance when we are being persecuted? Why can we rejoice when we are being persecuted? Well, let me ask you, would anyone in this world suffer for the name and cause of Jesus Christ if the Spirit of Jesus was not in their hearts? Do you know anyone who does not believe that the Bible is the Word of God, but who still seeks to be persecuted for righteousness' sake? Of course not. And that is why we can rejoice and be glad. Not because we are being persecuted, not because we are going through difficult trials, not even because of the reward which will be ours in heaven, but because by suffering persecution for the sake of Christ, we have visible affirmation that the Lord Jesus Christ resides in our hearts. We have visible affirmation that the Lord Jesus Christ resides in our hearts. We can see the Lord using us as his tool, the potter molding these feeble jars of clay. When persecution comes, the only response we should have is joy. The eternal joy of knowing that Jesus is using us as his personal tool. The joy of knowing Jesus, he has taken residence in our hearts. The joy of knowing that when Jesus resides in our hearts, nothing can remove him. Not even our own shameful actions. The joy of knowing that when Jesus sets his hand on us and calls us his precious child, then we are a child for eternity. No wonder those who are persecuted are blessed. Blessed with the kingdom of heaven. Blessed with a great reward in heaven. For they have been eternally secured by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. They have true hope and true joy. Persecution in the form of physical abuse may be a relatively unknown phenomenon to us, but that does not mean we are immune to persecution. Peter says we should not be surprised at the painful trial we are suffering. Jesus says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted." The challenge has been laid down before us. And there are two responses we can have. We can completely ignore the challenge and keep on thanking the Lord for the fact that we do not face persecution. Or we can allow ourselves to be challenged by a text which directs our attention to the danger of complacency about lack of persecution. Perhaps even being a little worried. Being persecuted Christians is a consistent portrayal of our walk before the Lord. If this is not a portrayal of your life, I hope you go home worried. Let's begin to come to terms with the fact that persecution in all forms is a natural consequence of being Christians in this world. Let's all seek to have a Christian lifestyle which attracts persecution, a lifestyle which is distinctly different. Let's be willing to prayerfully ask ourselves a most serious, telling question. Is my Christianity as faithful in all areas as Jesus expects it to be? Or are there certain unfaithful aspects which need to be confessed and worked at? Is my Christianity as faithful in all areas of Jesus as Jesus expects it to be? Or are there certain unfaithful aspects which need to be confessed and worked at? Here is a call to follow in the footsteps of our forefathers, the prophets. Here is a call to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Think about all that Jesus has done for you personally. Are we willing to take up this challenge in response to all sufficient love, grace, and mercy of our Savior, Jesus Christ? Amen. And brothers and sisters, I'd like to say that this sermon was for me. That's why I read it out to you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Help us to meditate on it and apply it to our lives as we walk with our Savior. Father, strengthen us, our children and grandchildren, as these times may come upon us sooner or later, that we are able to stand strong in the Lord's righteousness. In his name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we now sing hymn 488, all verses. And let us think about those words. Am I a soldier of the cross, a follower of the Lamb? And shall I fear to own his cause, or blush to speak his name? Let us sing standing up. Let us now lift up our hearts to the Lord and receive his blessing. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip us with everything good for doing His will, and may He work in us what is pleasing to Him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us now sing hymn 480. The doxology is hymn 149b. Oh, praise ye the Lord and sing a new song.